I want my baby to learn how to swim, but unfortunately, as soon as the swimming courses are on the website, they're always booked up immediately. I don't want to sit there every day and refresh the website to check for new courses, so I programmed the web scraper to do that for me and send me an email notification if there are new courses available. And in this video, I show you how to do that. In this tutorial, we will create a Python script and we will use GitHub Actions to automate the whole thing, because they are free to use up to a certain extent. That means as a prerequisite, you should have Python installed on your computer and have a GitHub account. Also, we want to send an email notification when the scraper has spotted something new. That means you need credentials to any email account. Here I show you how to set it up with a Gmail account. First, we create a GitHub repository. We give it any name we want, and we have a gitignore created for Python projects. After we have created the GitHub repository, we copy the URL and we just clone it locally and open it with VS Code. Now we create two files, a main.py for our Python script and a courses markdown file where we will save scraped data. I personally would recommend to use a virtual environment for the Python script to not mix up versions of dependencies with other projects you're working on. But this is of course optional. To create and activate a virtual environment, we run these two commands. After that, we install two packages, requests to retrieve the website and Beautiful Soup, a package for web scraping. Now let's start with the actual script. Basically here we fetch the entire HTML of the website with the content we want to extract, then we parse the HTML for the exact information and store that information in the markdown file in this repository. We start by importing the two packages, then we define a variable URL with the website we want to scrape. In my case, it's this one. We then call this URL using requests and then parse the HTML via Beautiful Soup. Now we need to think about what content we want to parse. For my site, it's these tiles, each representing a swimming course. We inspect the HTML of the page and start by finding a unique HTML element that contains all the elements we are interested in. For me, that's the section with the ID categories. We just parse this on the fetched HTML quite easily by looking for a section element with this very ID. Now let's look at the individual courses we want to store in an array next. These are represented by separate div containers that always start with course minus. So we're looking for children of the categories element that are a div element, and to do that we use a regex to look up for IDs that start with course minus. We then create a string variable whose contents we will write into the markdown file at the end. We assign a heading and then iterate over the individual course elements. Now, what content do we want to store for each course? Each of the parsed elements has a headline, H5, with the class car title. Then a short text with the course date in a paragraph. Lastly, there is an A element with the URL to the course's subpage. This URL is relative though, so I'll save the URL base here separately for now. Then I start. For each course, I first parse the heading, an H5 element with the class car title. The text is simply in a P element. And lastly, I then build the URL together from the base and the parsed href attribute of the A element. For a test run, let's just display the headline of each course on the console. And that works already. However, we have a lot of unnecessary spaces in the headline. We will remove them. For this, we use the regex package again and simply replace multiple spaces with a single space and finally strip spaces at the beginning and the end of the string. We will do the same for the text. Now we append one text section per course to the markdown string. We give each a heading and a link with the parse text as the link text as well as the URL in the markdown syntax. And as placeholders, we can just use curly braces here and pass the three variables using the format function. Finally, we open the markdown file for writing by passing a W and just save our string in it. We test the whole thing, open the markdown file, and it already looks not bad. However, we still have indentations in the appended lines here. This is because these indentations are also contained in the string variable. We simply remove them and start the script again. And now it works. We have a markdown file locally with the individual course elements. Great! Instead of a markdown file, you can of course just as well save the information as JSON, YAML or whatever. The advantage of the markdown file is that it looks good in a preview in GitHub, and besides, for our email notification, we will use a GitHub action that will automatically create an HTML email for us from the markdown file. That means we get a basic styling without any further effort. And now let's automate our script. To do this, we need to create a subfolder .github inside it a folder workflows and inside it a file actions.yml. Here we define our pipeline. We assign a name, define as trigger workflow dispatch. This will allow us to manually run the action for testing. We define a job to run on an Ubuntu machine. As the first workflow step, we actually always check out our repository first. Then we install Python and specify a current version for it. The GitHub action also has to install the required Python packages, requests, and beautiful soup on each run. To avoid problems with future versions of these packages, we should tell the pipeline which versions we want to use. There is a convenient way to do this using the pipregs package, which will save the exact versions installed in our virtual environment in a requirements.txt file. So we install pipregs and just run it. And now we have this file in our project with the exact versions. So the next step of our action will be to install these packages based on the requirements.txt. Now we can run the script that will scrape the website and save the content to the markdown file. After that, we use an action that commits possible changes in the project with a corresponding commit message. This means that if the Python script found new content on the site and created a new markdown file with it, this GitHub action will commit those changes to my repository. If there were no updates on the website, then the markdown file is not modified and this action is basically doing nothing. The last step is to send an email. However, this step is only executed if changes were detected in the previous step, as we only want to receive an email if the scraper has spotted something new. We use the action actionSendMail and enter the data for our Gmail account. As username and password, we specify variables, which we will then configure in GitHub. We add a subject, a recipient, and a sender. We specify our markdown file as the email body and have it converted to HTML via a parameter. Done. Before we push the code to GitHub, we first delete the content of our courses file. After that, we can commit and push everything. But for the pipeline to work, we still need to make settings in the repository. Under secrets and variables, actions, we put the credentials for Gmail. One new repository secret will be mail username and our Gmail address. We store this. As password, we use, in the case of Gmail, not our Google password. Google has a separate mechanism here called app passwords. For that, you just need to have two-factor authentication enabled on Google. To set up an app password, go to Google Settings, click on Security, and then on two-step verification. After scrolling all the way down, you will find app passwords. There you can create a new one for the app Mail and for the device Other. You give a name and you get a password. We copy this password and add it as a second repository secret in GitHub. One last setting, to make sure that our action is authorized to push to the repository, we go to Actions General and set the workflow permissions to read and write permissions. And now we're ready. We click on Actions, select our action and start it using Run Workflow. Now we can watch the steps being executed. This is actually quite fast and already done. Now that we've run the GitHub action for the very first time, of course it found some new swimming course dates, which means there will be an updated markdown file and it will send me an email notification, and that worked. And we are also able to view the updated markdown file committed by the action directly in GitHub. The very last thing we do is define a schedule for the action, since we obviously don't want to start it manually every time. We simply edit the actions YAML file directly in GitHub and specify a cronjob expression as schedule. With this one, the action will run automatically every other hour. We can commit that directly and we are done. The web scraper is ready and will check for updates for us from now on. I've put a link to my GitHub repository in the video description. Feel free to fork it and use it however you want to, and I also added some other useful links. I would really appreciate a like or comment. Thanks for watching. See you next time.